Good evening and welcome to the Fairfax Sports Report. I'm Joey Kamide with the Connection Newspapers, joined tonight by Jeff Graham, also of the Connection Newspapers. We have a great show for you lined up tonight, but before we get into it, we want to thank the underwriters who make this show happen. First, we have Ford Quality Care Service Center, servicing all makes and models, 703-383-6299. And we have CCI Screen Printing, the complete apparel design company, 703-978-0257. Jeff, as I mentioned before, we've got a good show lined up tonight. We're broadcasting live from Madison High School's gymnasium, where at the tip-off tournament that they're hosting, Madison is, as we're speaking, playing Robinson. The Robinson girls in the 6 o'clock game beat the Madison girls, defending Liberty District champions and regional runner-ups. So already an upset. We're a game in the season.
You know, it's kind of loud in here, but, you know, we're having a good time over here and looking forward to talking some more basketball and some football coming up.
I want to thank Pete Bendorf and Mark Merrill, the athletic director and principal over here, for letting us come over here and tape the show from Madison. Before we get into the football championships, which obviously we want to be sure to talk about and cover, Northern Region Council meeting today. Finally decided what they're going to do with the Loudoun schools. They voted by an 18-9-1 vote. I'm sorry, 18-9-4 vote to have Loudoun Valley in the national district for football, in the Dulles district for all other sports during the regular season, but in the national district for the postseason. Stonebridge, meanwhile, as anticipated, is a full member of the Liberty District. So really, I think this is probably the best scenario given the circumstances that the region was able to come up with.
And hopefully there's a bit of finality to it. I know the VHSL still has to vote on this in a couple weeks. You know, Pete Bender said before that this is probably the best they're going to get. So hopefully this is the last about redistricting we'll hear for at least one or two more years.
Had the opportunity to speak with Oakton's athletic director, Phil Levine, after the meeting. He said that he's kind of spearheaded an effort to file an appeal with the VHSL next year after the enrollment figures come out in March to try to shift things around, because as we all know, either Woodson or Langley is going to go up to Division 6, and then we're back to the same old problem of not having all the Division 6 schools in two districts and all the Division 5 schools in two other districts. So basically all this work will be for naught once either Woodson or Langley gets bumped up to 6, which is why Phil Levine said there's a very good possibility that they're going to appeal to VHSL. Doesn't mean that necessarily the VHSL will listen to them. As we found out in the past few months, VHSL isn't really listening to much of what the region council has to say. But, you know, it's an ongoing dilemma, really. And I guess we'll just catch it to sit back and see what happens in the spring.
Hopefully 2005 will be a better year for the region council dealing with the VHSL.
And then you toss in the new school in Lorton opening up. That's just going to throw things more out of whack.
A couple schools opening in Loudoun
in the next few years, which is going to impact Loudoun Valley's enrollment. But, you know, we'll have the new Lorton, right now called South County, in the Patriot District, at least initially, assuming the Patriot District accepts them. But they're going to be a Division 5 school, you know, right off the bat, until they start getting some more classes in and build up their enrollment figures. So really, it's kind of a mess if you look at the whole situation right now.
Something that, you know, unfortunately we have to deal with, and I think that the administrators in the area have done the best job that they can to, you know, try to figure stuff out. You know, it's not an easy job, but hopefully, like we said, it'll be done with pretty soon.
All right, enough of that. Let's get into the action. This past Saturday, Division 6 championship game, you had Oakton going in there with a 10-1 record against undefeated Robinson. At Robinson in Fairfax, the Rams come out on top 29-22, winning their second regional championship since 2001. Right there, you see Lucas Caprelli fumbled on the very first possession of the game. Oakton was able to...
Lee Karsten fumbles right here, and it's returned for a touchdown.
Avaita Stone, senior linebacker by Oakton, takes that in. This is the second possession for Robinson. Extra point by Donald Murphy was missed, so 9-0. They took the lead early in the game. But really, after that, it was all Robinson. The Rams, they see Lucas Caprelli on one of his four touchdown runs. This is 65-yard scamper down the right sideline.
And barely an Oakton defender in sight. I know this is a rematch from a couple years ago in the region finals. Oakton actually won that. You know, won that game 2 years ago, went on to the state finals before losing to Hilton. This game, Oakton, they gave up 545 yards to Robinson's offense. So I know we thought Oakton probably had the best defense, maybe this side of Robinson this season. You know, they shut down Westfield, who had a pretty good offense the week before. So I know we didn't expect, you know, Oakland's defense to be dominated like it was.
Yeah, and this is you know, like you said, they shut down Westfield. They held Evan Royster at 59 yards. Evan Royster, probably the best tailback in the Northern Region. Lucas Caporelli runs for 191 yards, 4 touchdowns, and as you mentioned, over 500 yards of total offense. That's, you know, and I think that was the thing after the game that disappointed Oakton's coach Joe Thompson and, you know, the most, because they had played so well defensively and offensively all year, and then all of a sudden, you know, just a real lapse on the defensive effort.
And especially after Robinson, I think, only scored 14 points against Centerville. I think if you would have said to Joe Thompson, you're going to score 22 points against Robinson, he would have taken it.
Absolutely.
You know, he certainly probably wouldn't have expected them to give up, you know, 29 points. So probably a little disappointing. But for Oakton, a great season. I don't know, probably most people expected either Centerville or Westfield to be in this game against Robinson at the beginning of the year. They're not open. So, I mean, to get here, Joe Thompson's second year, that's a great accomplishment.
And for Robinson, as I mentioned, their second regional championship in 4 years, their third under Mark Bendorf since 1997, they advanced to the state semifinals, where they'll play Hilton, the seven-time defending region champion from the Northwest region. So, two state powers going at it in the state semifinals. Robinson entering this game at 12-0. It's got to be the favorite over Hilton, who's 10-2. A little bit, I mean, in my opinion, down from the Hilton teams that we've seen in the past that come in just with these powerhouse teams. You know, obviously a very good team, but I think Robinson's got to be the favorite going in.
Mark Bendorf said on the Bendorf fans that, you know, after this Oakland, he goes up against a Hilton team that returns a lot from last year and, you know, is a very big team. And we know, as we saw last year, Hilton gave Westfield the hardest game of the year in the state semifinals, a game that I think, you know, Westfield pretty much wrapped up late before winning a state title. But, I mean, it should be a good game. It's probably the two best teams in the Northern Virginia area the last, you know, 8 to 10 years.
So it should be
a great game.
As we're wrapping up the highlights here from that game, want to be sure to mention some of the other teams that are advancing the state tournament downstate. An interesting bit of news, L.C. Byrd, who earlier in the season had, I believe, 5 or 6 wins forfeited and would have and then had to miss the playoffs, had those games overturned by the VHSL, and then went in and won the Central Region. So they're in the state semifinals. It's an amazing story.
I think they ended up receiving a fine instead of having to give up, you know, those games. And now they're in position to possibly win a state title. I know, you know, the people over at Centerville probably aren't too happy saying, you know, what happened last year. It seems like a similar situation, but, you know, the VHSL decides, you know, how they may. So, I mean, it should be an interesting past couple of weeks.
And on to the Division 5 game, which was played last Friday. Woodson coming out on top over Edison by a score of 29-25. This is the first regional championship in Woodson's history. Now, people forget, you know, before they had it, they've now been in the playoffs 3 years. Before that, they were off the map. They weren't a very good program for a good decade. But so people forgot that during the 70s, during the 80s, this was a very good football program. So a bit surprising that this is the first time they've won a region and gone to the state playoffs.
And I know, you know, 2 years ago they lost to South Lakes in the regional finals in a game that was 7-2. And then South Lakes went on, to go on to the state playoffs. Last year Woodson, I think, was a favorite, you know, to go, and they lost pretty early in the playoffs. So this was a good win for them. A referee getting knocked
referee
out of the game there.
Ready.
Woodson was dominant on the ground all season, and they actually opened up the pass a little bit in this game. But it was two similar styles, and Woodson comes out on top with their running game.
Yeah, Woodson's running game, probably the best in the region throughout the season. And Aaron Solomon, you got to give a nod to the kid. He steps in. Nick Olivero, as we know, broke his hand 6 weeks ago and has been very limited since then. He's fumbled a few times because he's wearing a cast or a splint on his hand, and that's affecting his running. So Aaron Solomon, who we saw bowling over that referee there.
Springing Matt Nickerson, Springing Nickerson here. I mean, when you have a speedy guy like Nickerson, he's going to open up the offense for a bunch of other people, for other people to step up, and that's what you saw, I think, in this game. So
Matt Nickerson with over 2,200 yards and 32 touchdowns as they go into the state playoffs. The Division 5 Region Offensive Player of the Year. Just an incredible season out of that guy. And really, we mentioned him in a pullout last week in the paper as one of the big surprises in the region this year. I mean, we knew he was going to be a good tailback, but who could have predicted this?
Right. I mean, you know, coming in, who are some of the good tailgaters going to be? Caparelli at Robinson, you know, Royster Westfield. But you know, it seems like every year you wonder who's going to step up for certain teams. You know, who do they have? And every year, certain kids step up, and Nickerson is one of them.
Now, as Woodson goes down and plays at North Stafford on Saturday afternoon in the semifinals, the other two Division V teams, Meadowbrook and Hampton. Now, you mentioned Hampton, and people all of a sudden say, oh, Hampton's in the state playoffs, they're going to win the state championship, because usually they do.
Yep.
I mean, they've pumped out Ron Curry, you know, just big names. I think they've won in the 80s alone, 80s and 90s alone, they won like 9 or 10 state championships, something absurd like that. So obviously a huge state power.
Right, and our Division V teams, like Pete Benner said before the show, our Division V teams normally don't fare as well as our Division VI teams. I mean, he thinks it's because throughout the regular season, they don't face the same teams that they face in the playoffs. So, I mean, Woodson's got their hands full in this one. We'll see how they do.
Well, you see some of the teams that we've had come out of the Division V last year. Madison, very good team, not dominant on either end of the ball, in my opinion. 2 years ago, South Lakes, again, a very good team, but not dominant. You have Woodson, that with that running game, they can control the clock. They can hold the ball for 30 minutes, which they've done a number of times this season, keep the ball out of the other team's hands.
Right.
They can. This, I think, is probably the best Division V team to go down there in a few years anyways.
And I think, you know, the way to defend Woodson is, you know, if you can stop the running game the same way that Oakland was able to shut down Westfield, you shut down Westfield's running game, it was a 33-0 game. You know, if you can shut down Woodson's running attack, then you pretty much have them figure it out.
Absolutely. Again, Saturday at 1, Woodson at North Stafford in the state semifinals. The Division VI semifinals. Hilton is at Robinson in Fairfax, 2 o'clock on Saturday afternoon. So be sure to get out there, support your local high school football teams. Now let's get on, Jeff. We're here at a basketball game, so we can't talk football the whole time. Can't talk football the whole time. So we want to preview the basketball season, as we're seeing some highlights right now of Madison and Robinson as they play. Let's start right in the Liberty District, right here at Madison. On the boys' side, Chris Kublak comes over from Oakton. A different attitude, really, with these Warhawks, and a very talented Warhawks team with Warren Edney, John Ogilvie coming back.
And I know Chris's Oakton teams, usually not the most athletic teams, but always seem to overachieve, always seem to play well come playoff time. Now he comes over to Madison, and he's got some athletes. You know, he doesn't have maybe the presence like a Jared Kuban down low, who is Oakton's all-time leading scorer, but I know, you know, you have a couple guys that you really like on their team.
Right. Absolutely, and Kublak comes over to the Liberty District, and now he sees Wendell Byrd again.
Right.
You know, he thought he got rid of having to face Wendell twice a year when South Lakes came over to the Liberty from the Concord District a few years ago. The South Lakes, especially with the Vaughn kid, the 6'8" sophomore transfer from Montrose Christian, joining Ryan Scott, the defending, I think he was district.
Chris Holmes was, but he
was all district last year.
Right, and he signed with, I guess, College of Charleston before the season, so he's going to be a D1 player, impact player. South Lake's a team that seems to get, you know, a transfer, a pretty good transfer every, you know, couple of seasons. Maybe not the best team during the regular season, but definitely one of the top performers year in and year out in the playoffs.
And, you know, last year I think the one thing South Lake's was missing, and it was apparent in the regional championship game, was that impact post player.
Right.
In Vaughn, they now have somebody that can match up with the Mike Freeman from Hayfield. And I think that, in the end, might be what puts this team over the top.
And I think that's what might separate, you know, South Lakes from a team like Hernan, where they're more guard-oriented, but against the Hayfields, you know, against the South Lakes, and, you know, maybe Westfield with Maurice Hubbard getting in there, you know, Hernan's a team that maybe is missing that, you know, presence down low. I know Larry Bennion, you know, was a pretty good player for them late last year. But I think that may determine who goes far this year, who has the better, you know, front court players, whereas usually it's who has the best, you know, who has the best guard, you know, whether it's Ricky Lucas for Hernan, you know, or Mike Lee for Hayfield, then, you know, the front court could play a very big role this year.
South Lake's basically a 5-guard team last year. I mean, they had maybe one post player, but, you know, this is going to really help them in the long run, I think. Woodson in the Liberty also expected to be very good. Now, move on to the Concord District. You're obviously very familiar with the district. I went to Herndon. I'm very familiar with the district. it's going to be fun to watch this year because you know Herndon with Scotty Reynolds back is going to be fantastic. Westfield with Hale, Errol Robinson, very good.
Right.
Oakton's a mystery because with losing Jared Kuban, the all-time leading scorer in the district, and a new coach, Chris Dukes, coming over from Chantilly, you know Jim Smith's going to have a good team over there. What do you see panning out in this district?
I think, you know, coming back, you have to give Herndon the nod simply because they're defending region champs. They beat Oakton, you know, last year. They lost, you know, a little probably prematurely in the region playoffs. And they have the best player in the region. You know, Scotty Reynolds averaged, I think, 24, 25 points last year as a sophomore. And if you look at Northern Region Player of the Year, you know, this year, I don't see any other player, you know, that can win it right now than Reynolds, and he can win it 3 years in a row. So, kind of same way on the girls' side, Jasmine Thomas won as a freshman last year. She can run the table, you know, 3 or 4 years. Well, so Herndon, you start with them. Westfield probably has the most balanced team, I would say. You know, they get a good transfer, a freshman, Maurice Hubbard. You know, he's going to start right away as a freshman. You know, Chantilly always seems to, put out, winning teams every year. Oakton, maybe a little down. You know, who knows? You know, like you said, they are an X factor. Centerville, they've struggled, but, they can play well, too.
Scotty Reynolds scored 25 points a game last year. From that team, Herndon's lost 5 of their top 6 scorers.
Right.
Now, I talked to Gary Hall yesterday. He says that Scotty might not average what he averaged last year because he's becoming more of an all-around complete player. But I don't see how he couldn't have to for them to be successful because they're missing all these scores.
Herndon was averaging 80, 90 points a game last year. Unless, they've gotten a whole lot better defensively, they're going to probably have to score 70, to 80 points to win some of these games. I mean, because they are very young in the front court. Larry Bennion, he came on late last year, but he's still kind of an unproven, player. He hasn't had a full season at varsity level. So, I see Scotty Reynolds having to score 30 points a game, on a lot of these games when they against the Westfields. He's going to need to score. He's going to need to score because I don't know who else on Herndon can step up, at this point in the season.
Reynolds at the ABCD camp, one of the nationally renowned camps, named the top rising junior of all the players, of the best players in the country, basically.
Right.
Narrowed his list to a number of schools including Maryland, NC State, Connecticut, Oklahoma,
Michigan,
who's been he's been on the guy since he was a freshman,
right.
Really. Gary Hall said that he'll have his decision made by this time next year. But, that's the who's who in national college basketball.
And I think that's really exciting because normally when we talk about kids from the area moving on to college, you see Ricky Lucas went on to, GW, some of the, but you don't see the premier programs coming, and getting kids in here. You see the Loyolas, the Furmans, but here's a kid that you could be seeing 3 or 4 years down the road playing in big, tournament games on a college level. And that's exciting just as a
Absolutely.
Fan.
Absolutely. Let's move on now. We hit the Patriot District. Our man Greg Wyszynski, the big Patriot District guy, not with us tonight. But you got to obviously begin and end with Hayfield and
right.
Mike Freeman and Jason Evans. Charlie Thompson's, again, got an extremely talented team and really has to be the favorite in the region, you think, this year.
I think Charlie Thompson, most successful coach, probably in the region. I think, 5 or 6 region championships, with different schools. And, they're the defending region champs. And, I know they graduated. Alex Woodhouse was a tremendous player for them last year, but they returned pretty much their core. And, like you said, Jason Evans, good shooter. Freeman, he actually signed with USC, so he's going to be going there. I think the thing with them is motivation. I know at times last year they were in some games that, early on in the regular season where you're like, why is Jefferson playing, Hayfield within 5 points? I think, but, as the tournament comes around, that's when they play their best. So I think, they're going to struggle maybe with some motivation problems out at the Patriot and maybe not seeing the best teams, early on. So, it'll be interesting to see what they kind of do during the regular season this year.
The early returns are in on Chris Kublank's move over to Madison. The Warhawks, as we sit here, are up by 20 points on Robinson at halftime, 43-23. So, obviously, Coach Kublank, barring any unforeseen turnaround in the second half, off to a good start at Madison. Want to get to the National District real quick. Wakefield appears to be the favorite. Edison is going to be very good, but they did lose the district's player of the year in Steve Smith, who graduated.
And I know that National District is always kind of, wide open. And, I know when they normally face you know some of the better teams from the other district, you know, don't fare so well. But you know, they have some good players in that district, and it'll be interesting to see when they match up with the South Lakes, the Hayfields, the Hernans. You know, if they are competitive.
Switch over to the girl side, Greg or okay. Jeff. I call you Greg. Sorry, Jeff.
It's all right. He gets paid more than I do.
We'll start back here in the Liberty District with Madison. As we mentioned earlier, upset by Robinson in the first round. Now, they lost Lee Campman. They lost Mary Beth Brown. So maybe it's a bit of a stretch saying this was even an upset. But, you know, this team won the Liberty District last year, went to the region championship game, and went to the state quarterfinals. Do they take a step back, you know, with teams like Marshall returning everybody, Anna Steg, Amanda Brown, with Woodson returning two all-district players and Ashley McCullough and A.J. Lemaitre, you know, are they the favorite? You know, again, a very possibly top-heavy yet very talented Liberty District.
I think there are so many, you know, good teams on the girls' side. You know, when we were coming out with our, you know, top eight list, it was kind of hard to say who should we fit in there. You know, there was 10, probably 11 teams we could have chosen. And in this district, you know, especially, you know, you can't lose the players like Brown and Campman. And, you know, expect to just to roll over other teams. You know, there's too many good players in this district. And I think, as you saw tonight, you know, with a loss, I mean, that's reality hitting home, you know, here early on in the season.
Denise Wojcik, the Madison coach, will really be – this is her first real test. She inherited very good teams when she took over when Pat Deegan left for Westfield. So we'll see how she does and how this team does right now. After losing these two real, you know, big impact players, 4-year Letterman, 3-year starters, 2 years on the all-region team. So, you know, but as Mark Bendorf always says over at Robinson, tradition never graduates. So we'll see. Now, obviously, Madison has a heck of a tradition. Let's switch over to the Concord District. You mentioned Jasmine Thomas earlier, the region player of the year as a freshman out of Oakton. Oakton, again, it's got to be a favorite. They went undefeated in district play, undefeated all the way up into the district championship game. But then Pat Deegan, speaking of Deegan,
that's right,
his Westfield Bulldogs beat him in the championship game and went on to the regional semifinals.
And Westfield, they bring back two of their top players, Marilyn Schaefer and Jessica Honesty. Jessica Honesty is out with a broken foot right now, should return probably late December. So Schaefer's going to have to play a pretty integral role early on in the season. But, you know, I think when you look at the Concord, you say Westfield, Oakland, clearly the top two teams. Chantilly, I talked to, you know, John Kelly this week. He thinks he has a pretty good program coming back. They return most of their players. Claire Blevins is going to be playing next year at Longwood. So Chantilly probably is going to be able to challenge. Centerville should be a little bit improved. And Hernan, Dwight Trimmer goes over there.
That's
great coach.
The X Factor.
Don't know what they come, you know, they bring back. But
this is the X Factor. Dwight says that he thinks that this team can compete, can be a team that gets a regional bid. Stephanie Bowers is back, Caitlin McManus. These aren't household names like some of the other girls that we've mentioned before. They got to pick up where Katie Haddell left off.
Right.
But, you know, he won two state championships. He's doing something right.
And last year, Centerville only won 4 games, but the fourth game that they did win was in the district tournament, got them a regional bid. So, I mean, you don't have to win too many games to get in the regionals. And, you know, playoffs is what counts.
To the Patriot District, you got to start with West Springfield, the defending region champion. Possibly taking a step back a little bit this year, though. You lose Sarah Carey Proc, Kristen Koonsman, among others.
Sarah Flanagan.
You know, they lost some gritty veterans from that team.
And Laura Haskins is back. You know, pretty much the only, you know, I think, true impact player for that team. You know, she's a great player, but I mean, like we said with Scotty Reynolds, only one great. And one great player can only carry a team, you know, so far.
Absolutely.
So I know Bill, Bill Gibson's one of the top coaches in the region. You know, he probably had some talent, you know, waiting in the wings, you know, over there, you know, in these last couple seasons. So it'll be interesting to see what Springfield does this year too.
Lake Braddock with Abby Robertson, bound to be very good.
Probably the top, you would say, post player, you know, in the region, capable of scoring 40 points.
Absolutely,
you know,
we saw it. She's done it before.
Right.
So she may have to do it. Casey Quigley, her point man the last few years, is gone, now playing at George Mason over in Fairfax. National District, talk about an impact freshman last year, Darina Campbell, the district's player of the year at Edison. She's back. Edison's bound to be very good once again. Mount Vernon, you know, even though Kenny Farmer's not over there anymore, they're always putting out good teams. So really kind of a mystery to see who's going to come out.
I mean, the girls' side, maybe even more than the boys' side, you have to wonder, I mean, because there's so many good teams. It's going to take 2 months to figure out who really are the contenders and who are the teams that maybe we thought were, you know, better than they are, and maybe they're not up to par.
We're now first week of December. Like you said, a few months. come late February. We'll see. I mean, it's going to be fun to watch, as it is every year, to see which of these teams
we got some good tip-off tournaments, some holiday tournaments, some teams traveling out of area to play some good teams nationally. So, I mean, this is always a fun time of year for teams.
Absolutely.
And then you get into the district schedule where you really kind of make or break your season.
Very good. That's our basketball preview here on the Fairfax Sports Report. Want to kind of wrap things up here. Don't forget, this weekend, we mentioned earlier, the Division VI championship game at Robinson. That is the FSN and Cox Communications High School game of the week. C.D. Hilton against Robinson. That would be broadcast on Saturday at 6 o'clock on Cox Channel 35. Next week, we'll have a postseason football discussion here on the Bendorf Bench and on the Fairfax Sports Report. The Bendorf Bench, you can see Wednesday nights at 10 o'clock and Fridays at 2 in the afternoon on Cox and Comcast Channel 10. As we mentioned, the Fairfax Sports Report, which you're watching right now. Next week, we'll continue our basketball preview into a second week, also review the state semifinals. That's broadcast as Thursdays at 8 o'clock, Fridays at 12:30, again on Cox and Comcast Channel 10. Fairfax Sports Report. Check us out on the web, www.fairfaxsportsnetwork.com. And once again, want to thank our underwriters, Ford Quality Care Service Center, servicing all makes and models, 703-383-6299. And CCI Screen Printing, the complete apparel design company, 703-978-0257. And we once again want to thank Pete Bendorf, the Director of Student Activities at Madison, Mark Merrill, the principal at Madison, for letting us do the shows over here tonight. Bendorf Bench with Pete, and Mark was taped before us. So really a great night for me personally, because I look forward to the opening of basketball season, Jeff. I know you do as well.
I guess we can congratulate Chris Kublink on his first win. Looks like they're going to win this one tonight. So congratulations on win number one for Chris.
Coach Kub getting it done. Once again, thank you for joining us here on the Ford Fairfax Sports Report. We'll see you next week.